It's showtime here with Dr. Zaden.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Time for change. Killed the
morning, everybody. Those were the incredible Rolling Stones, possibly the undisputed kings, long term of rock and roll. This is Dr. Minarcik doing a very bad follow-up to Mick Jagger, but today is Tuesday, October 2nd, and it's 9 o'clock here in the Chicago area. Today is our 8th session of Global Online Medical School Pathology, tuitionless. And today we're going to talk about genetic diseases. Today the music was all picked out by me, so for those of you who have sent me music, remember it's going into a big bucket and eventually we'll play it, but not today, because today I wanted to do my own selections. The big news for today, the big announcement, is that we have a very, very, very special guest here in our audience today. With me in the recording studio is Dr. Henry Zeiden. You may have, some of you may know him already. He's sort of famous, I guess. It's what I hope to be someday. He's here, and I'm teaching him some of my new techniques and some of my computer discoveries. And I'm going to have him say a quick hello. Also, my dog Woofy is here, but Woofy can't talk. I haven't trained him how to do that yet.
Good morning, everyone. I'm delighted, actually, to be with Dr. Minarcik for those 2 or 3 days to teach me, actually, his expertise on how to use webinar to give lectures. I did give, actually, in the past 4 lectures with Dr. Minarcik, and I hope to start it soon after I learn the technique. I appreciate your attendance, and I will get you back now to Dr. Minarcik. Thank you.
Dr. Zeiden is basically a one-man medical school. He teaches pharmacology and physiology and biochemistry, so we keep talking about someday of joining forces, and I will be the captain of the anatomical preclinical sciences, and he'll be the captain of the physiological preclinical sciences. Maybe someday we'll do that. We'll see. Otherwise, we're just going to be friends and have fun. I don't really think there's any other major announcements today before we get into our topic. But before I pop open the PowerPoint window, I want to tell you something new that happened since the last class 5 days ago. I made a spectacular new discovery. Now, you know that when you're at the session live, you can see well and hear well. And I've been able to capture that quality, you know, the high resolution quality, and I put them on movies on my website. But probably many of you have not been able to see those movies streaming. You probably have to wait for 10 minutes to download the 300 megabyte files, and then you could watch them. And you know, nobody wants to wait 10 minutes for anything. So what I've done now, and I'm starting to put them up on my website, is not only will you be able to see all of these original, perfectly identical, high-resolution movies instantly streaming, but they are even better quality compressions. So I guarantee you that if you, tonight, after I upload this movie, if you look at this animal again and listen to my voice, it'll be actually better quality than what you're seeing now. But if you don't hear and see us now, everything we've said so far has been away. So we have to go into our, you know, pathology exam right now. And the first question on the pathology exam is, did you hear us? Okay, good. And the second question on the pathology exam, you're all going to get wrong because you don't know the name of this animal. I bet you there's not one person there that knows what kind of animal this is, unless you are from Australia. Nobody has gotten it right. I got 10 wrong answers so far. You're all wrong. You're all wrong. Oh, don't feel bad because I didn't know what it was either. But if there's somebody here from Australia, you'll get it right away. This is a wombat. So if somebody said W, and somebody did, then you got it right. So you'll get the highest grade in the class for today. Okay, the wombat is going to be in the background while we talk about genetic diseases today, so let's not waste any more time. and start talking about genetic diseases. Okay, here is our first introductory page with some nice, beautiful, colored chromosomes by a technique called spectral karyotyping, which you're going to see in about 4 seconds, by the way. 3, 2, 1. I know you all see it now. We're going to talk about genetic disorders or genetic diseases, and some of you may have heard Shazina make our announcement for genetic diseases or genetic disorders. And I have to talk about the personality of this chapter. Now, you've probably heard me say with every chapter, this is my favorite chapter, this is my favorite chapter, this is my favorite chapter. Okay, folks, this is not my favorite chapter. It's a good one, and it's been incredibly improved over the last few years, but it used to be my worst one, and I'll tell you why. You see these little notes down here? If you were to walk up to any physician in the United States right now and say, what area of medicine do you feel the most totally stupid in? They would all say genetics. Now, for somebody like me who graduated from medical school 500 years ago, you know, that's before they even knew what chromosomes were, okay? But even the people that have graduated, like in the last couple of years, they know that the progress and the amount of information and understanding with genes and our ways of now exploring them and identifying them and modifying them in the laboratory, even sometimes now common laboratory techniques. You know, Jim Liu has a genetics lab down the street. They've increased so much that as soon as you graduate from medical school, you feel like you are totally stupid in genetics because it's passed you up. And that's the same type of horror or anxiety or dread or inadequacy that we feel. Now, that was a big factor of why this is not my best chapter. A mollifying factor, something that makes it a little sweeter, is the fact that we don't have to memorize the complete sequence of nucleotides in the human genome, okay? What we have to do here is just talk about genetic disorders in general and approach them from the point of view of either entire chromosomes or parts of the chromosome or individual genes or perhaps, in some cases, individual nucleotides. So that's the approach we're going to take. It'll be a classical approach, we might as well get going. I have to admit that there will be a little bit of shoveling in this chapter. For the most part, I think it flows pretty smoothly, but there's going to be some stuff under certain categories of diseases. You're just going to have to kind of memorize a little bit, or at least memorize if you're going to plan to take the step exam, because there's going to be certain categories of diseases of genetics I think you should pretty much know by recognition. So, you know, the classical thing is, so far, every single day we've had a class, I told you there's three kinds of diseases, inflammatory, neoplastic, and degenerative. And now I completely screwed everything up by saying, now there's also genetic diseases. Well, how do genetic diseases fit into those three categories? Remember, the categories we talked about are anatomic or histopathologic entities, which is the way pathologists approach diseases, microscopic diseases. Genetic diseases, in a way, are all diseases, because every disease I could think of, with some like incredibly obvious exceptions, are the result of our bodies, our protoplasm, our cells, our chromosomes, our genes. So in a way, every disease is genetic. You know, and we talked about aging and cell death. We said, well, do cells die because they're just destined to die? You know, they have the handwriting on the wall, or do they die because of wear and tear and environmental challenges? The same argument can be said about genetic diseases also, or diseases in general. Do we get diseases because our genes aren't strong enough, or they're susceptible? Or do we get diseases because we have good genes, but all this stuff is thrown at us in the environment, pollutions and microbes and challenges and trauma. So in the perennial discussion of what's more important in diseases in general, genes versus environment, of course the answer is none of them is the answer. They're both important. But I bet you the more you learn about diseases, the more you'll generally think towards the genetic side rather than the environmental side. So let's just say in the classic battle of genes versus environment, you know, genes generally is gaining ground. And it's not just because we know so much more about them now. It's not just because we have identified the human genome. Now, another type of disease that often doesn't quite fit into our three anatomic classifications is the concept of a congenital disease. You know, a congenital disease is not exactly a genetic disease. It's just a disease of malformation, usually embryologic malformation. And that's ultimately dependent on genes, but you know, you can also say congenital doesn't quite fit in with the three categories. The adjective environmental doesn't quite fit in always. And also the term immune disease. Just like we said, every disease could be thought of as being a genetic disease. You can also say every disease can be thought of as being an immune disease because our genes determine our immunity, especially chromosome 6, which we're going to talk about next chapter. I wanted to say one more thing about this, but I kind of forgot. I'll probably think about it later. Okay. Mutations, normal, healthy genes, every gene susceptible to a change, a permanent change. A permanent change in a gene, whether it's a single nucleotide or trinucleotide or a base pair of 5 or 10 or 10,000 nucleotides, is subject to change. A mutation is defined as a permanent change in the DNA. Now what we're going to do, and the way this chapter is going to be organized, is that we're going to at first start about talking of mutations of individual genes. And it could be an individual nucleotide. We give some really obviously good examples of that. You know, sickle cell disease is always the best example of that. Then we talk about going up on those nucleotides and getting into sometimes even visible or certainly detectable portions of chromosomes, which we call a chromosome mutation. It's very often visible, and if it's not a visible with G-banding or the way we classically stained chromosomes, then most likely we could see it's visible by another tremendously emerging lab technique called FISH, F-I-S-H, F-I-S-H, fluorescent in situ hybridization. And finally, we're gonna talk about diseases of entire chromosomes. What happens if you have an extra chromosome? What happens if you have a missing chromosome? Those are genome mutations. So there we are going up the ladder. You can see these under a microscope, even a lousy one. You may see these largely if you have a good microscope and special stains or FISH. And of course, nobody has really quite seen a gene yet under a microscope, but we understand the concept. It's a segment of your nucleic acid as expressed in the nucleus or translated into or transcribed into messenger RNA or translated at the level of the ribosome. So, how can you mutate a gene? Well, we all know the concept of DNA, don't we? One way you could mutate a gene is to simply knock out one of the nucleotides. That's the simplest type of concept. Another concept at the very simplest level is to substitute a nucleotide with another one. These are all ways to cause mutations, okay? So here's a good example. Here's your DNA. You all know what that squiggly thing is. You all know that at the transcription level, you turn it into messenger RNA. Messenger leaves the nucleus, goes to the ribosomes, determine the production of amino acids by virtue of a trinucleotide per amino acid. So glutamic acid is GAG. Guanine adenine, guanine. If theoretically you knocked out that adenine, and for some reason, traumatic radiation inherited, that gene was mutated, you now have a uracil. You no longer have a GAG, you have a GUG. And whereas GAG ultimately codes at the ribosomal level for glutamic acid, it's now coding for valine instead. So we may have a perfectly normal polypeptide or protein or enzyme or structural protein, except for one little thing. Instead of a glutamic acid, somewhere in the protein chain, there's a valine. And you think, well, gee, that can't be too bad. You know, it's only, they only missed by one. But the fact is, that's the difference between having the beta chain of hemoglobin, or beta chain of the globin portion of hemoglobin, being normally hemoglobin A, to another type of hemoglobin called hemoglobin S. And that's sickle cell hemoglobin, isn't it? And that can make a big, big difference in, you know, in that patient's life. Technically speaking, besides just having a single point mutation, which we just talked about, you know, there's no law saying that you can't mutate portions of the DNA which do not code for various types of proteins, the non-coding sequences. And if you have DNA that's working and it's not dead or garbage or junk DNA, which of course there is, but if you have a portion of DNA which is not making some kind of protein, most likely it's in the business of regulating, perhaps transcription, or perhaps other growth processes. So mutations in non-coding sequences might result in defective growth regulation. So I know what you're thinking automatically. You're thinking that when we go into the various theories of carcinogenesis, which is defined as mutations in growth regulatory genes, that's probably where the mutation is occurring there, not in genes that give rise to polypeptides or proteins. Now think about it. When we talked about the mutation in sickle cell disease, we had a simple GUG as a substitute for GAG. Okay, it was a simple mistake, but it did not change the overall structure of the entire DNA molecule. So if you have a deletion that is not a multiple of three, where you're not going to ultimately make the same protein with a simple one amino acid mistake, that's called a frame shift. And it's because the entire DNA frame shifts because you're changing it. It's like knocking one rung out of a ladder and then trying to put that ladder back together again. But you have to shift the whole thing, can't you? Well, that's called a frameshift mutation. Now, another type of mutation, and there's really a few diseases now in which we see this, is called a trinucleotide repeat. Now, if you remember, if you have a polypeptide or a protein in which you have a variety of amino acids, you generally have to have a variety of trinucleotides which code those amino acids. But let's say for some reason in the process of that DNA getting mutated, there's a certain sequence that repeats itself dozens, hundreds, maybe thousands of times. And those are called trinucleotide repeats. And there's a syndrome we're going to mention later on, perhaps twice, called the Fragile X syndrome, in which you have trinucleotide repeats. And if you think Fragile X stands for Fragile X chromosome, you're probably right. Because in that type of mutation, for some crazy reason, and you know, maybe somebody knows the reason, but I certainly don't, you have repeats of the same trinucleotide sequence over and over and over and over again. Now, let's say you have a gene mutation. Technically speaking, it means you may have an abnormal protein. We've seen that with sickle cells, the primary example, hemoglobin S rather than hemoglobin A. But let's say that we have a gene mutation which would result in, if it's defective in the DNA, it carries over into the messenger RNA. So there's an error in transcription too. Or actually, there really isn't an error in transcription. It's taking the perfectly abnormal DNA, and it's making the perfectly abnormal RNA, or in this case, messenger RNA. Now, these defects that are now in messenger RNA, which acts as the template for the ribosomes, or the ribosomal RNA, are now carried over into translation. So we have a mutation in the DNA, winding up as carrying that mutation over into the messenger RNA at transcription, and it's now carried over into defective proteins or defective other processes at the translation or ribosomal level. If it's at the ribosomal level, it's really defective proteins, isn't it? And sometimes you could have these abnormal proteins being produced without actually impairing the rate of synthesis. So, you know, you're genes, your ribosomes, are making perfectly nice normal proteins, except they have errors in the DNA. So here's the organization of the chapter now that we've defined mutations and types of mutations in general. The single gene mutations, they follow the classical Mendelian inheritance. I don't have to go over that. You know about alleles and dominance and recessive. You learned about that in third grade. But the single gene mutations are going to be following the classical Mendelian inheritance. If they carry over into the chromosomes, they're going to result in that gene being passed on in either a dominant or a recessive or a sex-linked fashion. And then we're going to talk about multifactorial inheritance, and that's a little bit fuzzier. It might be fuzzier at first, because if it's hard to understand exactly what one gene does and all the ways it could be mutated, believe me, it's even much harder to understand multifactorial. But multifactorial is easier to understand if you remember or think that whenever you have a disease that's described as multifactorial, in other words, multigenic, it's really a case in which you have abnormal soil. So the soil theory, the soil of your body, the soil of your protoplasm is determined by multiple genes. And if you know it, your soil is very similar to your mother's soil, your father's soil, your children's soil. So the closer you are in family, the more that soil can get abnormal things happening in it. And finally, we're going to talk about disorders at the entire chromosome level, many of which are visible, even under regular microscopy. So there's the classical Mendelian inheritance patterns. We know that there's a large category of autosomal dominant diseases in which you need both mutations or both abnormal genes paired up. In autosomal dominance, all you need is the one allele, the dominant allele, to be there and the disease is present. In autosomal recessive, you need both. So think about it now. Even though that's called autosomal dominant, which means the presence of only one allele can cause it, it's still only one allele, isn't it? In autosomal recessive, you have two alleles. So in that way, you might think that the recessive is even stronger than the dominant. So if you remember that you need two abnormal alleles to cause an autosomal recessive disease and not just be a carrier, for example, you're going to realize that once you get the disease, though diseases are bigger and stronger and occur more quickly and are more uniform than diseases caused by a situation in which there's only one abnormal allele. So the dominant ones are one, or single trouble. The recessive ones are double trouble. And of course, we know that there is the concept of mutations which involve only the X chromosome, you know, one of the sex chromosomes, not an autosome. And of course, in those cases, which we'll understand, or you probably already do, they occur only in males because all it takes is one of the chromosomes to have it, because the Y chromosome is not the analog of the X chromosome, okay? And of course, females can only be carriers. You know what? I don't think I'm going to pop out the question window yet. I think you all understand that stuff. So let's take the case theoretically of an autosomal dominant disease. And remember, we said all that means is that you're in the heterozygote state and all you need is one abnormal gene to cause the disease. Whereas in the recessive, you need two, right? So because you only have one, even if it's called dominant, they're not quite as strong and early and uniform as the recessive diseases. So in autosomal dominant disease, you know, neither parents may even have the disease. This could be a new mutation, okay? It's reduced penetrance, okay? It doesn't maybe not fully express itself, perhaps in combination with the environment or other genes it may. But generally speaking, the autosomal dominant disease are reduced penetrance, and that's also related to variable expressivity too, isn't it? Because some people may have a severe disease, some people have a mild disease, some people may have no disease. And even though it's called dominant again, remember, there's only one bad guy there. There's not two. So that means that the person may have a delayed onset. So many of the autosomal dominant genetic diseases are in adults. They don't express themselves till you're 50. Polycystic kidney disease. Adult polycystic kidney disease is a classical example. You don't know you have it until you're in your 50s and you have renal failure. Okay? And by that time, you've already had kids. That makes it even worse. And it's usually the result of a reduced production of an inactive protein. So if you take all of these things now and think, how is this different from autosomal recessive? We're going to skip to autosomal recessive right away. Now you're in disease where you got two bad guys, okay? So you're in a homozygous state. It's a uniform expression. It's complete penetrance. You know it early in life. These are childhood diseases. And rather than the disease causing what we call reduced production, we now have a situation in which there is a loss of function. And most of the diseases we call inborn errors of metabolism, all of the huge, huge category of lysosomal storage diseases, these are autosomal recessive. And they're generally much more common than the autosomal dominant diseases. So let's look at some examples and some pedigrees. So this is the thing that I threatened you with. And the autosomal dominant diseases, there's a long list. I just put, let's say, the top 10 on there. I hate to do this to you, but I think you're just going to have to kind of be aware. You don't have to memorize this list, but you should know that if you hear these diseases, that people that have these diseases have them even if only one allele has the defect. Huntington's disease. We'll talk about that. Often called Huntington's chorea. It's a degenerative CNS disease. Neurofibromatosis, we'll mention that. A lot of the muscle, the myotonic dystrophies, tuberous sclerosis. You may have never heard of these, and we're not going to go into them all today, but we will throughout the course. Hereditary spherocytosis, one of the most common coagulation disorders. If you have a patient with a abnormal bleeding disorder, it's most likely going to be von Willebrand's than any other disease. Marfan syndrome, disease in structural proteins. The hyperelasticity syndromes, plastic man, rubber band man syndromes. Some of them are autosomal dominant, some are autosomal recessive. Disease in the structure of collagen 1, resulting in abnormally brittle bones that break easily, called osteogenesis imperfecta. We mentioned this before when we talked about collagen, if you remember. Even in the collagen disorders characterized by achondroplasia, which is usually cartilage 2, okay, or collagen 2, I mean. Remember we said it was cartilage. in familial hypercholesterolemia, resulting in an abnormal transport protein. That could happen if there's just one gene that's present, not both. And another kind of obscure hematologic disease involving the breakdown of heme pigment called acute intermittent porphyria. I don't know how you're going to do this, but you just have to kind of remember these are autosomal dominant diseases. The easy part is the pedigree. Because it's autosomal dominance, you know that both boys and girls can get it. And because it's dominant, then all it means is passing on of one of the genes. You don't have to worry about both of them being there. So it doesn't skip generations. In autosomal recessive, it might skip generations, as often does skip generations, simply because you need both guys there, which is a much lesser mathematical possibility. So there's a pedigree for autosomal dominant, and there's the pedigree for autosomal recessive. They're both boys and girls, but look, we skipped a couple generations there. That's the big, big, big difference. And here's some classical autosomal recessive diseases now. And remember, autosomal recessive diseases in general are a lot more common than autosomal dominant diseases, because if you have only one allele that's abnormal, there's a very, very good chance it won't even express itself in a disease. But if you have two, what would you say is probably the common denominator with all of these autosomal diseases? Well, you know they're all in kids. They're not much variation in how they are. They express themselves early in life, complete penetrance. But it looks like a lot of these things are the results of perhaps enzymes which cannot process substrates. So if you have a classical genetic disease, an enzymatic disease, in which you have an abnormal enzyme, so you can't process a substrate, and therefore the substrate builds up and causes diseases, then most likely it's an autosomal recessive disease. And the single biggest category of those are the so-called lysosomal storage diseases. Okay, let's go to the third one now. Let's go to the sex-linked. And if you think about the sex-linked diseases as diseases which will be present if they're on the X chromosome, well, the male doesn't have the counterpart of another X, does he? So he's going to get the disease. You know, the Y chromosome is not homologous to the X. So it's only in men, sex-linked diseases, technically. And all of his sons are going to be okay, right? Because he's not giving them the X chromosome, he's giving them the Y chromosome. But all of his daughters, who are getting his X chromosome, are going to be carriers. But no women will have the disease. Now, heterozygous females, which they are, they really have no phenotypic expression and they're just carriers. So you might think of this as sort of a autosomal recessive situation, because females don't get the disease. Now, sometimes I hear people talking about, you know, sex-linked dominant or sex-linked recessive. It's a really confusing term. So I prefer to just think of it as sex-linked to keep it simple, okay? Now, later on in this presentation today, I'm going to show you a picture of a blown-up X chromosome. And I'm going to show you parts of that X chromosome that are mapped. And I'll say, well, this band or this section or this subband or this region is going to result in a G6PD deficiency or diabetes insipidus or hemophilia A or B or the classical Jerry's kid, Duchenne muscular dystrophy, okay, the most common type. So even though I'll admit that you probably don't know what a lot of these things are already, some of them you may have heard of, whereas I told you that you should know the list of dominant and recessive autosomes, you must recognize these as sex-linked diseases. And we'll talk about them later. Some of them you can think of what they are simply by looking at their names. You know, somebody that has the inability to make antibodies, agammaglobulinemia, G6PD deficiency causing a potentially severe form of hemolytic anemia, the classical hemophilia A and B for factors 8 and 9 respectively, Jerry's kid is a boy, Wiskott-Aldridge, an immune disease, diabetes insipidus, a disease of the posterior lobe of the pituitary, a disease causing gout, which is a genetic disease rather than an overeating disease, and Fragile X syndrome, which we also said was due to a trinucleotide multiple repeat. These are all boys, okay? Keep that in mind. Here's a sex-linked pedigree now. See, there's only boxes, there's no circles. And does it really matter whether generations are skipped or not? No, it doesn't. If you see a pedigree and the only affected things are the boxes rather than the circles, you know that's sex-linked. It may or may not skip generations. So those are how you differentiate those according to the pedigrees. Now, let's get back to our logic again. This is not medicine, this is logic. We're going to talk about single gene disorders. We're going to the individual genes now. We haven't traveled up the chromosome yet. If you have an abnormal gene, it could be the result, it will result in an abnormal protein. We've seen the classical example of that with sickle cell. Well, what are proteins? Well, some proteins are enzymes, some proteins are receptor proteins on surfaces of cells, or carrier proteins. Some proteins are structural proteins. Now, we've already seen a list of the so-called collagen genetic diseases. Of the 18 types of collagen, we saw, you know, different types of abnormal collagen producing different diseases. And remember, genes or proteins also determine how susceptible a cell is to a drug. So technically, you could have a gene which is defective, and therefore the protein is defective, and therefore, because of that, it could make that cell more susceptible to a drug. And another classical example, that certain drugs, especially the anti-malarials like primaquine, causing or initiating or triggering off G6PD deficiency. Or, you know, foods could do it too. Okay. Are you still with me? I'm not going to look for the answer to that question. Let's take the category of structural protein defects. I think you know what Marfan syndrome is. You may have heard of it. It's people that are really tall. They frequently get aneurysms in their aortic arch. Some people say that Abraham Lincoln was one. Some people say the former Osama bin Laden was one. And in Marfan syndrome, it's a structural protein defect. Now, if you remember from cell biology or biochemistry, there's this protein called elastin. Okay? Elastic fiber. If you had a really, really big a microscope and you're looking at elastic fibers, you see the elastic fibers are made of two things. First of all, it's made of kind of an amorphous gooey substance by the name of elastin, okay? But giving that gooey thing a little bit of strength and making it elastic are these little fibrils or fibrillin. So you have elastin and you have fibrillin making up an elastic fiber. Well, in Marfan syndrome, fibrillin 1 is the major component of the microfibrils of fibrillin, and that's the abnormal structural protein. It's not this gooey elastin in the middle, but it's the fibrillin, and it's the result of a fibrillin 1 defect. Now, if you are biochemistry jocks, you know, like Dr. Zeidan here, he's probably looking at me right now and thinking I'm stupid. There's also fibrillin 1 and fibrillin 2, if you remember. But in Marfan syndrome, the defect is only in fibrillin 1. Now, let's take something that's very complex and summarize it. It's called Ehlers-Danlos syndromes. And you notice I said syndromes, I didn't say syndrome. And generally, Ehlers Danlos syndromes are defects in various types of collagen. Some of them occur as autosomal dominant, some of them occur as autosomal recessive. There's at least six different types. And if you remember, we showed that the other day, and it looked like it was kind of complicated. But the bottom line of the Ehlers Danlos syndromes is people have hypermobile joints. You know, and if you want to think of, you know, Spider-Man or, you know, the man from the circus that could, you know, tie his arm in a knot or something like that, it's because they have hypermobile joints. We have a very, very famous rheumatologist at our medical school. I won't mention his name, or who knows, maybe I will. But he gave a really beautiful lecture on this, and he said, how many of you people are really good dancers or athletes or can do backflips? You know, they're about, you know, about 20% of the big lecture hall stood up. He says there's a 50% chance you probably have some form of Ehlers Danlos. So it's a variety of collagen defects, but the bottom line is it's hyperelastic skin and hyperextensible joints. I feel the need to tell a horrible joke at this point, so I will. Last year, I don't know if there were laughs because I didn't look at the question box, but I said that, you know, the classical example of Ehlers Danlos is even from the Bible. And there was a phrase in the Bible where it says, Moses tied his ass to a tree and then walked 3 miles. I know that's a terrible joke, but I just had the desire to say it anyway. Here is receptor protein defect examples, the common ones. You know, there's a disease called familial hypercholesterolemia. Okay, that means it's familial, that means it's genetic. That means it's genetic because there is a abnormal production of the LDL receptor. Okay, so cholesterol transport now across the liver cell is impaired. And if you can't transport cholesterol cell across the liver, the cholesterol is going to build up, isn't it? And because it builds up, there are other mechanisms, we call them the scavenger system. If you have too much cholesterol in your blood, now, because it can't go be processed by the liver, the macrophages start to chew it up, okay? And guess where they deposit it? They deposit it in the walls of the arteries. So, do people with familial hypercholesterolemia get premature heart attacks? If you heard somebody that had a true documented myocardial infarct at age, you know, 31 or 25, most likely other people in the family did all. So now you know the story, and now you know when you look at macrophages and they're foamy, now you know why they're foamy. That's the cholesterol. That's the scavenger system, because the LDL receptor can't transport the cholesterol across the liver cell. The easiest concept to remember, in fact, if I had to use this as the only slide for the entire talk, I would say, if you know, if you remember that enzymes are proteins, and enzymes are also proteins which change other chemical compounds. So if you had an enzyme that was structurally or deficient or perhaps didn't work because it didn't have the right sequence of amino acids or missing something, the enzyme's not going to work. And because enzymes process substrate and they make products out of them, remember that? And they don't work, that means the substrate builds up. It could be harmful, it could accumulate in the cell, it could cause malfunction of that cell. It could cause tremendously huge organs wherever those cells are. And the classical examples of the enzyme deficiency diseases, the single by far biggest category, are your lysosomal storage diseases and the so-called inborn errors of metabolism. And now that I opened up the door to lysosomal storage diseases, I almost feel like I have to go into it now, because we're going to have about 7 or 8 slides now, and then we'll take our break after this. We're going to have about 7 or 8 slides in which we talk about examples of lysosomal storage diseases. Now, let me tell you, when I was a medical student, I loved biochemistry. You know, I hate it now, though. I don't know why. Maybe I just got older. But if you remember from biochemistry, there are biochemicals called glycogen, sphingolipids. You know, the word sphingo comes from the word sphinx, the enigmatic, mysterious sphinx. Dr. Zaidan knows that because he's from Egypt. The sphinx was enigmatic, so when they first discovered these compounds, of which gangliosides are included, they were called sphingolipids because they were mysterious. The sulfatides are a specific group of biochemicals. The mucopolysaccharides, you know, one of the forms of what happens when a carbohydrate gets together with a protein, or the proteins get together with lipid-like substances. These are all things which build up, or they get stored at first in the lysosomes when the enzymes needed to process them, to change them into what they have to be changed into, are absent or missing or defective. And look, we also have a few terms I'll throw at you quickly too. The fucosidosis, mannosidosis. If you think that fucosidosis is the buildup of fucose, which is a carbohydrate, or mannose, which is a carbohydrate, simple type of a sugar carbohydrate, because the enzymes needed to process them, to metabolize them, don't work or are missing or mutated. Or buildup of substance like aspartyl glycosaminuria. These are all lysosomal storage disease. There's another one called Wolman's disease, and if you have a defect of acid phosphate, you know, an acid phosphate deficiency is there because the enzyme needed to produce it from its precursor is missing. I just want you to remember, I don't want anybody here to ever be spooked by the concept of lysosomal storage diseases anymore, like I was. Just remember these are the categories. Start out with the simple one, glycogen. You all know what that is. It's the chief storage form of glucose. And when enzymes needed to convert glycogen into things like glucose, for example, are missing, the glycogen builds up. And if glycogen is normally rich in things like skeletal muscle, cardiac muscle, liver, you know, those three organs probably have, what, 99% of your glycogen storage? They then build up in those organs. And they build up in the organs where, in the case here of this muscle, I don't think it's liver, it could be liver. It builds up such that it swells the cell, and then it even washes out in processing and almost looks like fat. So a lot of the site glycogen storage diseases might look like there's fat being in there simply because it's washed out during the histologic processing process. You should remember that if you hear the word Pompeii or Van Gierke or McArdle, those are the three ones that are discussed the most or the most common. If I was going to be a sadist, I would probably put these three things on a test and I'd say, what do they have in common? And you all know these are glycogen storage disease. And Pompe's disease is also called type 2. And various organs are affected, and they're all affected differently. In some types, cardiac muscle is not affected. In some types, people die of cardiomyopathies at early ages. So liver, muscle, heart is where the glycogen is. What about the sphingolipidoses? We all know that this mysterious compound, like the sphinx, are basically lipid-type compounds, but they have something called a sphingosine base. Okay, and I don't want to get into biochemistry any more than that because I don't really understand it. One of the most common and often referred to sphingolipidoses, they've even made movies about it, it's called Tay-Sachs disease. Okay? It's an accumulation of a ganglioside, which is a sphingolipid, because the enzymes needed to process it are defective or absent or mutated. Very common in the Ashkenazi Jewish race, as many as 1 out of 30 are carriers, and you know that because this is an enzyme deficiency, and it's manifested early in kids, and it's uniform, and it's frequently fatal as well, it has to be autosomal recessive. So you do the math. If the whole world was Ashkenazi Jews, and they just married each other randomly, what is the chance of of one person having disease if the carrier rate is 1 out of 30? It's a lot, isn't it? Okay? In the case of the ganglioside, the specific sphingolipidosis inside of a neuron, you know this is central nervous system tissue. You know that the small cells with the halos are probably oligodendrocytes. You know that the less common cells with the big nuclei are neurons. And look, not only is this a big neuron, but the cytoplasm of it is just loaded with ganglioside because it can't be processed by the retina. Another thing to remember is that you'll probably never see this. In fact, my son is an ophthalmologist. He may have never seen this yet either, but if you're lucky, you may see a bright cherry red spot in the macula. Not always, but if you do, you know, you could give yourself a little gold star, or you could show all your friends. Or if they have a patient like this in the hospital that has a cherry red spot, I guarantee you they're going to keep that patient in the hospital for 6 years just to make sure every single medical student can say, I saw a cherry red spot in the macula in a Tay-Sachs patient. Okay, what about the sulfatidosis? This is the general structure of a sulfatide. Okay? I don't know, it looks like there's a large carbon portion, it looks like there's a benzene ring in there, but the sulfatides are technically sulfated, you know, there's your sulfa, galactosylceramides, and they're an important compound of myelin, especially the myelin that we saw here, which is surrounding the oligodendrocyte. Why do all of these little cells have halos? Because that's myelin. Well, if they had a disease called a sulfatidosis, that myelin accumulates, interferes with proper central nervous system function. And so it generates a family of diseases, or if you would remember that in the so-called metachromatic leukodystrophies of the brain, which we're going to go into in the brain discussion, Krabs disease, Fabry's disease, Gaucher's disease, Niemann-Pick. These are all buildups, abnormal buildups causing diseases, the general category of which is called the sulfatidoses. And it's sulfatides, cerebrosides, sphingomyelin are the buildups. So here's the test question. I'm not going to give it to you, but I'm going to put these five things on a list. I'm going to give you a multiple choice. I'm going to say, which of the following does not belong here? And I'm going to say metachromatic leukodystrophy. I'm going to say Crab. I'm going to say Fabry. I'm going to say Gaucher. And I'm going to say Niemann-Pick. And I'm going to put something there like, how about if we say something like neurofibromatosis? Which one does not belong here? Well, it's obvious, you should recognize that when you see these, they're in that category of lysosomal storage, as it's called, the sulfatidosis. Here's one of the most common sulfatidosis called Niemann-Pick. Luckily enough, it's usually not fatal, but it can be. There's three different types. We're not going to tell you how to differentiate them. But the type of sulfatide that builds up in Niemann-Pick disease, called sphingomyelin. Okay, so you know it has something to do with myelin, and you know it's mysterious. That's why it's called Sphinx at the beginning. And the enzyme in Niemann-Pick disease, which is missing, is called ASM, or sphingomyelinase. Okay, if you want to call it Niemann-Pick-ase, that would even be better. And because it's missing, the sphingomyelin in those cells needed to be processed can't be processed, so it's built up. It can build up in the liver. It could build up in the central nervous system. it could build up whenever you have sphingomyelin. It could build up in the brain. Now, if it builds up in the liver, it could build up to such a degree that it actually causes significant hepatomegaly. It's also in Ashkenazi Jews like Tay-Sachs. And here's a picture of a liver. I think you can recognize this as a liver. In fact, you know, I'm going to pop the question box open here. Can you recognize this as liver on the left? Just say yes or no. If you say no, that's okay. Okay, everybody's saying yes, though, so I know I'm on target. Now, you probably don't know what this is on the right. Those are just cells that are accumulating sphingomyelin. They could very easily be from the bone marrow. Now, let me ask you this. If so far I told you that sphingomyelin accumulates in cells in the liver and in the bone marrow and in the spleen and the brain, what kind of cells do you think they are? That's M. Somebody said macrophage. So yeah, of course they are. They're foamy macrophages, aren't you? In fact, if I showed you this slide and I said, could this be cholesterol inside of these macrophages? Could this be somebody with familial hypercholesterolemia? You'd probably say yes, but it's just a foamy macrophage. That's all it is. By the way, what's another name for a macrophage? Because if you're a pathologist given this lecture, which I am, you might be tempted to call it a histiocyte. For some reason, pathologists love to use the word histiocyte rather than the correct word, which is macrophage. What about Gaucher's disease? Okay, this is buildup of a compound called a glucocerebroside. Okay, you should know that that's what builds up in Gaucher's. There's various types. Most of them are type 1. And in type 1, there's no central nervous system involvement. So in type 1, it's not only usually not fatal, but it's usually asymptomatic. I knew a hematologist who was just looking at a routine bone marrow, and he sees a lot of these foamy cells, and he says, you know, I bet you this person has Gaucher's disease, and they don't even know it. So once again, it's building up in white blood cells, macrophages again, foamy macrophages, in the liver, spleen, lymph nodes, and bone marrow, because that's where the macrophages are. And those, the reason why it's there is because there was a buildup of cerebroside because of a lack of an enzyme to process them. And do we have the name of the enzyme down here? No, actually, we don't. Okay. I think we're almost done with the lysosomal storage diseases in general, except for the mucopolysaccharidoses. Okay, you know mucopolysaccharides have to have a muco or protein component and a saccharide component biochemically. And there's basically two main types, and they sound similar, and they both begin with HU. One of them is Hurler, one of them is Hunter. In these autosomal recessive diseases, which they all are, Hurler was the first one discovered as a mucopolysaccharide, so it's called type 1. Hunter was the second one. But in both cases, they're built up of mucopolysaccharides. So if I told you that Dermatan is a chemical compound that builds up in Hurler's disease, then you would think that it's a mucopolysaccharide. If I told you that heparan, I put a big A there because most people think it's heparin, but it's heparan. Heparan sulfate builds up in Hunter's disease, then you could understand what the defects are here. Now, when we take a look at the Downs or trisomy, we're going to say that there's a certain classical recognition for patients with this disease, and it's not quite as simple for the Hunters and Hurlers people that are significantly involved. You know, they could be kids because, once again, it's autosomal recessive, isn't it? Expresses itself early in life. They generally have coarse facial features. They can also have problems with their cornea and joints. They're usually mentally retarded, but not nearly as common or having the impact of the Down syndrome. And they can have so much buildup of these mucopolysaccharides that they very often excrete it in the urine as well. So you can actually have increased sulfates from the breakdown of these compounds in the urine. I guess that would be a quick test, but you would probably do more to test, including genetic tests. And by the way, all of the diseases, all of the genetic diseases we're talking about, by now, they usually have very, very, very specific genetic tests, which we're not going to go into, to cinch the diagnosis. So if you get somebody with a coarse facial feature and they got sulfates in their urine, you would say, well, yeah, that sounds like it's mucopolysaccharide, but there are tests in all of these things where they could absolutely confirm the genetic defect in the laboratory. Remember, I told you we're going to throw in a few more, and these are quickies, and they all follow the same pattern, however, is that these compounds build up when there are absence of enzymes to process them. There are also autosomal recessive lysosomal storage diseases, buildup of fucosides, you can't process the fucose. Buildup of mannosides, you can't process the mannose. Buildup of aspartyl glycosamine, resulting in going in the urine as well, you can't process that compound. The one that has a name of a man is Wolman syndrome, and it's a disease of acid lipase. And acid lipase means that for some reason the cholesterol triglycerides are built up. They can't be processed properly. And an acid phosphatase deficiency. And I think I put it down here. We could look it up. These are basically snaps from Wikipedia. An acid phosphatase deficiency is because of mutations of the ACP2 beta subunit, or ACP3. So if you know that there's an ACP gene mutation, you think that that probably stands for acid phosphate. Okay, we're done with a large portion. We're about half done. We're at the halfway point. You know, at this point, I generally don't hate this chapter too much anymore, but I have to ask your opinion. For those of you that have been here, you know, for a lot of the classes, and I can see a lot of familiar names, was this kind of overwhelming? You don't have to hurt my feelings. You don't have to worry about hurting my feelings. Some things, especially the genetic diseases, you have to realize it's not going to all be fun and games, you know, like hemodynamics. And so you have to struggle a little bit with biochemistry, but the concepts themselves at the beginning are very easy. So keep that in mind. Dr. Zaida and I are going to take a 10-minute break. We're going to play some nice music for you that I picked out. And you're going to be looking at the wombat while you're doing it. And we'll see you in 10 minutes, folks.
Be the return to yourself. chali badal rahi hai roop zindagi chhaav hai kabhi kabhi hai dhoop zindagi har pal yahan ji bhar jiyo jo hai sama ho raha har ghadi badal rahi hai roop zindagi chhaav hai kabhi kabhi hai dhoop zindagi har pal yahan ji bhar jiyo jo hai sama kal ho na ho
slight mistake when I announced the music today. I told you they were all my selections, and they are. However, I selected a couple of them that students gave me. I played them a couple of times and I really liked them. And this was one of them. And it's called, the one we just heard was Kai Ho Na Ho. I have no idea what language that is. If somebody knows what it is, you know, you could type in the answer right now. And the first song that we heard, I also picked because I liked it. And it's not my song. It was submitted by Dinesh Kumar Devarajan. And if I mispronounce your name, I'm sorry. Okay, so the second one was Hindi also. That was given to us by Adil from Mauritius. And the first one was given to us by Dinesh Kumar. So thank you. Proper credits is given. Two more little ideas I got during the break when I was relaxing is I just want to say again the discovery that I made a couple of days ago since the last class in the quality of the movies is absolutely spectacular. So for those of you that are here, if at some point in time you download this, when it gets onto my website, you're going to say, oh my God, the movie is better than the actual live session. Why the hell should I bother going here? But I appreciate your coming anyway. And another thing I noticed is that over the years I've been doing this, I've been ranting a lot less. When I first started doing this, I would tell those students how badly medicine sucked and all of the terrible pressures and problems. And I still refer to them, hopefully in a less emotional way, but I don't find myself ranting as much because I enjoy this now. And I don't have to do all those horrible, horrible, crazy things that you people are dying to do. So let's continue our discussion on genetic diseases. And we're about halfway done. And we just finished talking about the lysosomal storage diseases, and we have to mention the classical genetic disease of all time. Technically, it's not a lysosomal storage disease, but is an enzyme disease. It's when you don't have the enzyme homogentisic acid oxidase. And as you might have figured out by now, that means you can't oxidize homogentisic acid. And you know, homogentisic acid is basically an important in tyrosine. Remember the amino acid tyrosine metabolism? And if you remember, tyrosine is a precursor to melanin. So you might guess that if you can't oxidize homogentisic acid, which is a acid which degrades tyrosine, okay, then you're going to have wind up a buildup of black-like material. It's not exactly melanin, but it's in the same general intermediate family. So the alkaptonuria patients, black urine, black nails, and black cartilage as the phenotypic expression. You're in the lab, you might ask yourself, what's the most common cause of black urine? Well, most people that would see this in the lab, they would probably say it's hemolyzed blood. But it's not blood. It's homogentisic acid. And sometimes the cartilage can be so black that even though you have a nice little piece of skin surrounding it, like in the pinna of the ear, you can still see the black through the skin. And here you go. Here's your black nails. This is not somebody getting ready for Halloween trick-or-treating. These are real nails that are also pigmented darkly because of the buildup of homogentisic acid. And here you go, this is in the skin now, you can see these pigmented compounds, and it doesn't look like there's a hell of a lot of it, but believe me, this is enough to show considerable black discoloration of the skin as well. And by the way, for those of you who remember, whenever you see a pigment that is not totally black, but more of a golden, refractile reddish brown, it's more likely to be an intrinsic pigment, something in your body normally has, rather than an extrinsic pigment like anthracosis or tattoo pigment, which comes from the outside, doesn't it? Neurofibromatosis has to be discussed clinically as well. There's two forms of it. The most common form, the classical form, is also called von Recklinghausen's diseases, in which you have these little skin tumors and tumors deeper than the skin, like in the nerves and deep inside. I knew a girl that had one in her brachial plexus called neurofibromas. And you also have a proliferation of cells, melanocytes or pigmented cells. So they also have these little brownish things that look like coffee, and that's why they call them cafe au lait spots. And by the way, there's little brownish pigmentations of melanocytes in the iris as well. You can see them as little dots here, but in the blow-up of them, they look like more than dots. They look like little nodules. So they call those Lish nodules. I asked my son if you've ever saw one. He says he sees them all the time. So those are little pigmented tumors in the skin. They're neurofibromas. They might look like this microscopically. They don't look very exciting. They just have these little spindly cells. You also can see things that are not tumors or bumps, but they're just melanocytes, coffee-colored proliferations on the skin. And there's your Lish nodules. Now, that's number one, most common one. There's also another type called type 2, and you can guess that that was probably discovered after type 1. And the thing with type 2 is the predominant diagnostic feature of type 2 is that these little tumors at the origin of their acoustic nerves. I believe that's 7th nerve. I guess I should have checked. But in neurofibromatosis type 2, you can have, if you see at the cerebellar pontine angle over here, see those little tumors? They're bilateral, aren't they? And they also get meningiomas as well. So you know a meningioma is going to form wherever you have meninges. So a good place for a meningioma is, you know, where the meninges are, in the falx and the convexity. And it's a very, very complex genetic situation. I don't think I'm qualified to really discuss it. It's so complex. But I think as a tidbit of information, you know, these are classical genetic diseases, type 1 with the neurofibromas, and in type 2 you're probably going to have some type of central nervous system tumor, like an acoustic neuroma by the auditory nerve, or a meningioma where you usually get meningiomas. We're done with the single genes, and now let's move on to a more complex, but in a way even a less complex concept of multifactorial, or multigenic, if you want. Now, a lot of diseases can be expressed in terms of, you know, whether the abnormal genes are there or not. But, and so they're usually diseases that are either there or not there. You know, either you have phenylketonuria or you don't, okay? But with multifactorial diseases are usually diseases that have a lot of gradations to them, or what they call discontinuous traits. For example, hair color, eye color, skin color, height, intelligence. Now, you know, you can't divide intelligence into, you know, genius and dummies. You have this thing, a whole variety, a bell-shaped curve of gradations. And those are the diseases of multifactorial inheritance. And you can't explain it on one gene, why a hair is a certain color or eye, or it can't. Remember, there's all these variations, or height is another good example, or even diabetes. You know, I guess you could say, well, you have diabetes if you flunked the glucose tolerance test, but that's not really true. You have something called prediabetes, you have impaired tolerance, you have metabolic syndrome. You have all of these gradations. You can have severe diabetes, so diseases which express themselves as a wide continuum are most likely multifactorial. And guess what? That's really most of the diseases, isn't it? So, if you want to think of multifactorial inheritance as the soil theory, and by the way, this is my theory. I didn't look this up in any book, but it's best explained by soil. If your soil, if your protoplasm, if your cells, multiple genes, you know, can produce diseases, then people with similar soil are statistically much more likely to get those diseases too. not exactly inherited or not inherited, but likely to get them. So here's classically the features of multifactorial inheritance. It's not really a Mendelian thing, although ultimately it is. The expression of disease is determined by not one, but multi, or a number. So that's why it's called multifactorial or multiple genes. And if you were to say, well, what is my chance of getting a disease that's not a genetic disease, but it's in the family? And that disease can go anywhere from 5% to, you know, much, much higher. And if you're an identical twin, it's way, way, way higher than 5%, but it's never 100. So if your mother or your father or your sister or your brother, first degree relatives, have a disease that's multifactorial, perhaps any of these diseases that we saw down here, you're likely to get it. Statistically increased if you have another sibling that has it. It's more than 5%, but it's never 100%. Remember, these are diseases of not of continuous traits. Now, I should have taken out that diabetes because that's a discontinuous trait. So I think that's a conceptual error I made over there. Like height, weight, these are continuous traits. And if you want to think of diabetes as discontinuous, either you have it or you don't, you can. But in generally, diabetes is sort of continuous as well. So I'm throwing it out. Now, this is a thing that's going to really bring you closer to the concept of multifactorial disorders. Take a look at these so-called classical multifactorial disorders, like cleft lip as a congenital disease, congenital heart disease, not one gene but many, coronary heart disease, hypertension, gout, diabetes. What can you say about these diseases? You could say it's just about every disease that's not classically genetic, isn't it? So the list goes on. And I would like to propose a theory about multifactorial disorders. And as a general rule, we could say just about every disease that you have a statistically increased chance of getting if it's in your family is a multifactorial disorder. And that pretty much is the whole gamut of all the diseases we see in robins, isn't it? Okay, so we move from the one gene to the multiple genes, and now let's go to portions of the chromosome now. Now we're getting into visible parts of genetic diseases. You know, in karyotyping, you basically count your chromosomes, and you have 46, which is 22 times 2, which is 44, and then your 45th and 46th chromosome is your X and Y chromosome if you're a boy, or X and X if you're a girl. Standard karyotyping. So the conventional notation in the genetics lab is if you say, if I come in and I say, what's my sex, and they do the genetic testing, they'll say it's 46, XY. If a girl comes in, 46, XX. That's a conventional notation. But they could do much more than count chromosomes or cut them out and put them on pieces of paper or see them. They can also stain them. Now, if you remember, we had a stain we may have mentioned called the Giemsa stain. It's not as good as the standard hematoxylin and eosin stain, but it's better for some things. You know, it doesn't differentiate a nucleus that well from a cytoplasm, which H&E does. But it has the feature of staining chromosomes very nicely, so you could see little bands in them. So technically, if you do a good stain, you have a good microscope, you can see 500 bands, you know, per haploid chromosomes, you know, which is 23, can't you? And you know that chromosomes have that little centromere in the middle, and then you'll have one arm going one way and the other arm going other way. And the shorter arm is called P, because P stands for petite. And the longer arm is Q, because that's kind of like the opposite of P. So that's basically your basic pattern for karyotyping. And in the old days, and even now in some labs, you know, you could arrest cells in division, and you could have ways of cutting out those chromosomes, staining them with Giemsa, blowing up. And you'll see that some of the chromosomes will look real long, and some of them will look like tiny dots, but they could be stains. So within this one chromosome, I bet you could probably count 20 or 30 little bands, and if you really blew it up nicely, you could count a lot more. So the A chromosomes are the tallest ones, the B's are the second tallest, the C's are the third, the 4's are about medium. When you get into the D's, they're getting shorter, and the E's, the F's, and the G's. So your chromosomes A through G is the longest through the shortest. And what's the difference between the three A's? Well, the difference between the three A's is what is the PQ ratio? So within this, you'll see some short arms being a lot shorter than the long arms, and some they'll look about equal. So that's your basic classical nomenclature for chromosomes. And look at your X and Y chromosome. Look how your X chromosome looks like it's about 8 times bigger than a Y chromosome. There's a lot more genetic material there, isn't it? And some people say that's the reason why there are more boys that are born slightly than girls, because the Y chromosomes are shorter, so therefore they weigh a tiny, tiny bit less, and therefore they're faster than the X sperms. The Y sperms are a little bit faster. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's a classical explanation, because it is a slight statistical difference. Now, here we go again. We said A through G is whether they're long or short, the 3A ones being the longest, the G's being the shortest. And within the A through G, now we depend on whether the P and Q ratio is. So in some of them, the P is a lot shorter than the Q. In some of them, they're almost identical. Now, you have to remember this part. We've already defined chromosome. We've already defined P and Q. Now, you have to define within P and Q the region, the band, and the subband, because now we're looking into that chromosome deeper and deeper. So you have the P arm and the Q arm, but within the P there might be a few regions, and within each region there might be something called a band, and sometimes you can even go as far as a subband. So look at, here's your X chromosome. Remember I told you we'd be looking at it, and here is the centromere. Here is the P, because it's shorter than the Q, because it's petite. Here's the longer one, which is called Q. And look, we could see the regions. There's two regions in P, and there happens to be two regions in Q. Excuse me. Now, within the two regions in P, the second region has a band, 1 and 2. And this region only has 1, so it doesn't divide. But within this band now, there's 4, and within this 2, there's 3. And that's basically how you're breaking it down in terms of regions. And within these regions lie genes. You can say that a gene, for example, is located on such and such chromosome, such and such arm, such and such region, such and such band, and such subband. You know, even if the whole thing is like gazillions of nucleotides, you could say they're within a certain region. So in the X chromosome, we're looking at the same list of what we told you to memorize as the sex-linked diseases. We said hemophilia B and A, okay, they're near to each other. Fragile X is between them. Leishmanian, which is a abnormal form of uric acid metabolism by a defective X chromosome gene. X-linked agammaglobulinemia, okay, only in boys. It's a disease of immunity. Excuse me again. And other various things. So to memorize parts of the X chromosome which give rise to diseases is also the same as the list of sex-linked diseases, isn't it? Now let's say up until, maybe a generation ago, that's about as far as we could go. We couldn't see nucleotides, obviously. We still can't really see them. But we could see arms, regions, bands, and subbands. Now, within a subband, there are still a wide variety of genes, okay? Maybe only 10,000 nucleotides, for example. Well, now we could see those with a technique in the lab called FISH, fluorescent in situ hybridization. These are the classical gene probes. And the logic of it is, I think, simple. Now, I know the technique is very complicated, and I've seen it done, and they have to go through a whole bunch of chemical steps, but the concept is incredibly easy. You take a portion of a DNA fragment. Maybe it's only a couple thousand base pairs. Up there they say like around 10,000, but they could be 2,000 or 20,000. And you label it with the fluorescent dye. So if its complement is there, you know that it's present. If its complement is not there, you know that it's not present. So when a portion of the chromosome lights up, you could say, you know, yeah, that's there. Or if it doesn't light up, you say, that's not there. And this is a very, very commonly used technique. And it's one of the main tools we have now to identify, not just in the hematologic malignancies like leukemias and lymphomas. We say now, like when you read Robbins, you read about any particular disease, they're going to tell you the defect is at this chromosome. The reason why they knew that is because of fish. Okay, so here's a fish listing of chromosomes. And remember, it's much better than G bandings, because now you can see very tiny micro deletions on the chromosome, much smaller, because now you got fluorescent probes, or complex translocations, not just a simple crossover, but a knot practically, or problems with your telomeres. And if you have a telomere alteration, okay, you might wind up having a tumor, because telomeres are growth regulators. They are the ones that often determine the number of times that a cell can divide. So you have something wrong with your telomeres, you got cells that can divide too much. And what does that mean? Cancer. Here's some more fish stuff. And in this one, probably wasn't needed, because you could identify triple chromosomes simply by counting them. But in this one, we got a probe that attaches to a portion of chromosome 20. And you know there's three of them on here. So a person has three triple chromosome 20. That's a, you know, triploid disease. It's like Down syndrome would be 18, but there's also a triple 20. And this one is a tinier. It shows that there's maybe a small deletion in chromosome number 22 because the fluorescent probe may not have gone where they want it to go, and therefore you could diagnose a very, very common genetic disorder where there's a deletion in portion of chromosome 22, which we're going to talk about because it's a common one. Here's another technique. I really don't want to say much about it, but you know, when I put the covers on these lectures, I look for really spectacular, colorful pictures, and there's even a way you could identify chromosomes by different colors. Now, it doesn't mean you're using a variety of different stains. It means there may be only one or two stains, but there are ways to alter these digitally. Remember, this is a digital technique. This is not a staining technique. You may have remembered when you look at pictures of electron micrographs, you know, at the level of electron microscopy, color has no meaning because it's a very short wavelength. But you could still false color certain things. You can make bacteria look pink and, you know, so forth. So this is spectral karyotyping. It's beautiful. Not too much value in the lab, but I thought I'd throw it in there to let you know of all the cool things that we're doing. Now, the cytogenetic disorders are diseases of large portions or whole chromosomes now. Cytogenetics. Euploid is defined as having the perfectly correct number of chromosomes, in which case is 46, which is an exact multiple of 23. Aneuploid is not having the exact normal number of chromosomes, or not an exact multiple of 23. That's all that it means. It doesn't mean too much, it doesn't mean too little, it just means it's not an exact multiple of 23. Now, a monosome or monosomy is when you're lacking one of your autosomes. A trisomy, an autosome, is a non-sex chromosome. A trisomy is when you have an extra autosome. So rather than having 44 autosomes and two sex chromosomes, you have 45, an extra one. So Down syndrome, you know, trisomy 18. Or you can have extra or lacking sex chromosomes as well. We're going to talk about the common ones. You can also have cases where chromosomes are deleted, chromosomes break, chromosomes tie knots, you know, chromosomes, all kinds of weird things. Every single thing you could think of, if you have a string and your extra string hanging from your shirt right now, and you just pull it off and you look at that string and you say, geometrically speaking, how many ways can I screw up this nice, beautiful, straight string? I could tie a knot, I could snip part of it off, I could make it into a circle. Anything is possible with chromosomes as well. Here's some more definitions. A translocation is when one portion of a chromosome switches, you know, with another. And you would think, well, it's more likely to switch in the Q arm rather than the P arm, simply because the Q arm is longer. Well, you could have translocations in the P arm as well. Or another thing that it could do is divide in such a way that you have two big pieces and tiny pieces. So here's something that happened near the centromere, and rather than this chromosome having a nice pink and a blue one, it has a large, the Q arm joining with this Q arm and the P arm joining with this. That's theoretically possible too. That's just a geometric fact. What about an isochromosome now? The definition of an isochromosome is something that doesn't split up along its longitudinal connection, but it splits up the other way. That's possible. They're a disease of isochromosomes. I can't think of a long list right now. Or the easiest concept is to think, well, what would happen if just a part of that chromosome was knocked out or deleted? It's more likely to be knocked out in the long arm, simply because the long arm has more area or more chance to be knocked out. So that's a deletion. Or what about an inversion in which you have a chromosome, but part of its length is simply inverted? It's not translocated with another chromosome, it's just inverted. So rather than having P over here, and Q over here, and the segment of Q starting with blue, it just reverses itself. It's the same segment, so anything is possible. You want to put that chromosome into a ring? You could do that. There are ring chromosomes. Some of these things are crazy things you see in malignant cells, in which you can see chromosomes, you know, that look like, you know, the city of Cleveland's interstate highway system. I mean, anything is possible, and everything has been described. So let's talk about the common cytogenetic diseases. Diseases you can detect or certify simply by looking at the chromosomes and detecting all these crazy things. Well, in the autosomes, you can have trisomies. In the sex chromosomes, you can also have extra things, not only trisomy, not only an extra X chromosome, but maybe two or three extra X chromosomes. Or you can have the absence of one of the sex chromosomes, like in Turner syndrome. You know she's a female because she has an X. You know that Klinefelter is in guys because they have a Y. But in Klinefelters, rather than having one X and one Y, they have more than one X. Usually it's two, but it could be three or four. I've even seen as much as five or six. And the more X's they have, the more it's likely to be associated with mental retardation. Turner syndromes are absence of a Y chromosome. Sometimes it's not complete absence, but it's usually complete absence. Now, in trisomy 21, Down syndrome, the most common cause of mental retardation, you have an extra 21. You can also have autosomes where there's an extra 8 or 9 or 13 or 18. A lot of them are fatal, and I guess I should say thank God, but some of these can result in very, very, very severe mental retardation. Trisomy 21 itself is, you know, horrible disease. Or the most common cytogenetic disease in which a deletion is present. And you know this is the 22nd chromosome, so it's a short one. It's one of the shortest ones. So you know it's in the G group. And if you look into the... now that you know the arm, if you look into the region in the band, it's 11 and 2. So you know exactly where in chromosome 22 there's a deletion. And that causes a situation, a disease that goes by a variety of about 10 different names. But the best name for it is 22q11.2 deletion. I'm throwing a lot of names at you for this one, but that's the common denominator. So here's trisomy 21, Down syndrome. You do standard karyotyping, you can see, well, there's an extra chromosome. It's not 46, it's 47, and the extra one is very short, so you know it's either F or G. And look, it looks exactly like the G ones, in which the centromere is like very close to the end. So that's the extra 21 chromosomes. That's Down syndrome. You're not supposed to use the word mongoloid anymore. That was a commonly used term. Now they're simply called Down syndrome, trisomy 21. And you know, you may know somebody that has it. You may have seen them somewhere. There was actually one in, you know, in close in our family. And you know, you just can't help but think that these kids are very, very special in the eyes of God. They don't, you know, they're born with a lot of potential problems. And the thing I want to tell you about Down syndrome, though, is if you went to the Google search engine and just did Down syndrome picture, almost everybody on there would look like this, okay? There's a characteristic facies, and I can't explain it to you in words. So all I have to do is show you a classical one. Go to Google right now if you want. Just do the image search Downs. Everybody will look like this. Their problem is that extra chromosome, and I don't want to say anything more about it. I will say, however, that the problems that they get are heart defects, acute leukemias, infections, atresias, or narrowing to the point of almost no lumen of their GI tract, and in the United States, number one cause of mental retardation. Now, how do you get an extra chromosome? Well, think about it. Do you remember the part of anaphase or mitosis where the chromosomes are supposed to pull apart? And they're pulled apart by those little strings. I forget the name of them. Well, let's say they don't pull apart, or they're non-disjunction. That means that one of the cells is going to get an X chromosome. Or let's say that they do pull apart, but there's a significant lag. That would be a factor or cause it as well. So what's the cause of a trisomy 21 or any of the other ones? The classical explanation would be maternal non-disjunction or anaphase lag. And I hope that that's logical. By the way, I'm going to ask you, is that logical? You're afraid to say no. That's why everybody's saying yes. Okay, let's go into the most common significant chromosomal deletion situation is when there's a deletion in the region in band 11 and dot 2 of the long arm. Remember, this is Q. This is long. P is petite of chromosome 22. And there's a deletion. And it's probably too small to be seen by standard karyotyping. So you have to do FISH. And you can see that your gene probe for that area doesn't match. So that's how you diagnose this. Now, did you ever hear of DeGeorge syndrome? Did you ever hear of thymic hypoplasia, sometimes called congenital thymus aplasia? Did you ever hear of velocardial facial syndrome? Because velo means soft palate, they have palate problems. Cardio means they have congenital heart problems. And facial means they have kind of a characteristic facies, but not exactly as recognizable as Down syndrome. Well, all of those terms are names for this. And by the way, sometimes they call it Strong syndrome, and sometimes they name it after a guy that has a really long Polish-sounding name like mine, for the guys that have worked on it a lot. I think another nice name for it is CATCH. Even though I generally don't like mnemonics, CATCH, the C stands for cardiac anomalies. Well, we already knew that because we said it was called velocardiofacial syndrome as well. The A stands for abnormal facies. I'm going to show you some characteristic facies. There's problems with the thymus, so you know there's problems with immunity. because there's problems with T cells. And from an embryologic point of view, it's due to a failure of development of one of the pharyngeal pouches. They can have a cleft palate. You know, the root word for palate is vela, which is another term for the soft palate. So that's the vela of velocardiofacial syndrome. And because that pharyngeal pouch also gives rise to the parathyroid, if you have a problem with it, you can also have hypocalcemia as well. Parathyroid deficiencies, hypocalcemia. Here are some of the poster children. I wish I could tell you that they look as characteristic as the Downs, but they have kind of a cute smile. You might not recognize them as being, you know, abnormal, but these are, you know, last year's or probably now 2 or 3 years, the poster children for velocardiofacial syndrome, which is the preferred term if you don't want to remember 22q11-2. What about the sex chromosome disorders? Okay, well, in the sex chromosome disorders, there's problems with development. If you're a boy and you have a Y, that's the definition of male, isn't it? One great way of defining what a male is, even though there's a lot of different ways, if you have at least one Y chromosome, you're a boy. Okay? It doesn't work that way with women, but because men also have an X chromosome. But in the two most common forms of sex chromosome disorders, which is Turner syndrome for females and Klinefelter syndrome for males, they both have significant problems in sexual development. So they may not even know they have it until it's time to reach puberty, and they don't, and that's when they're worked up. And in males, Klinefelter syndrome is probably one of the most common causes of infertility. So let's start with Klinefelter. Number one cause, male infertility. There's hypogonadism, small testicles, small penis. And the thing is, they all have X's, but they have more than one Y. So if we said the normal male was 46 XY, well, this is now 47 XXY. Or it could be 48 XXXY. Or it could even be 49XXXXY. The more X's, the more likely there is mental retardation. Generally, most of them are just one extra X, 82% of the time. And whereas they have short penises, they have long arms and legs. So, especially legs. So, if you want to just remember, you know, short penises, long legs, that's like the predominant anatomic feature, other than the fact that, you know, they're infertile, and they usually don't even know they have a problem until puberty time, just like with the Turner syndrome. So here is a Klinefelter's. They may have a little bit of extra breast development. They don't have much hair. They may have a female pattern of pubic hair rather than what they call the male escutcheon. It's more of a triangular pattern like a woman. And that's classical, long legs, you know, short penis. What about Turner syndrome now? Turner syndrome is a woman who doesn't have a Y chromosome. So rather than 46XY, she's a 45Y. Now, if you want to be a real stickler, you could say, well, sometimes it's just part of the Y that's missing, but most of the time it's most of it. And also, there could be also a mosaicism where some of the cells in the body are normal, some of the cells are classical 45X. The two, probably the if you were to go to a medical student, you know, forum and say, start rattling off the list of things that is found in Turner syndrome, almost always at the top of the list they'll say webbing of the neck. And it's kind of like, I'll show you a picture of it. Another thing, if you were to ask pathologists to rattle off a list, they would say streak ovaries, because their ovaries aren't really well formed. They're just kind of streaky. They talk about edema of the hand, and of course, the most feared defect is congenital heart defects. But if you only want to remember three, think of neck webbing, streak ovaries, and the possibility of congenital heart defects. If you want the full picture, you know, here's a normal hysterectomy specimen. Do you see how the ovaries are significantly bigger than the fallopian tubes? But look, and here, the ovaries look like they're just a little thickening in the broad ligament. That's why they call them streak ovaries. And of course, they're not fertile. And there's a possibility of heart defects, and especially coarctation of the aorta. There's your extra fold of skin by the neck. They're amenorrheic. And I don't know if this is like always at the top of the list, but I understand there's some nevi or pigmented flat spots that are extra. Everybody has nevi, but I guess they have more or at an earlier age. So now that we've talked about Turner's and Klinefelter's, let's ask ourselves, what's a hermaphrodite? Classically, a hermaphrodite, ideally, is somebody that has both full testicular as ovarian anatomical and physiological function. So a true hermaphrodite has both mature testes and mature ovaries. But most of the people that they call hermaphrodites now are more likely a pseudo-hermaphrodite. In other words, if it's a male, they have testes, that's why they're called males, but they have a lot of female characteristics as well. If they're a woman, a female pseudo-hermaphrodite has ovaries, but she has a lot of secondary male characteristics. True hermaphrodites, I don't know, they say they're very, very rare. There's probably a few of them in the world, but you'll never see one. So what is sex? That gets us to the bigger discussion. What is sex? Well, there's genetic sex, and that's either presence or absence of a Y chromosome. That's how we defined it before. But remember, there's also gonadal sex, or the presence of absence of either testicular or ovarian. And that's the phenotypic expression, isn't it? But there's also ductal sex. Remember in embryology, the Mullerian duct gives rise to the female genital tract, and the Wolfian duct gives rise to a lot of those little structures in the male tract. So that's what you can talk about, ductal sex as well. But to make things simple, if you have a Y, you're a boy. If you don't have a Y, you're a girl. Last couple of things I want to mention, and I always feared this slide because it's always the most complex, but so far everything we've been talking about in terms of genes always follows this great pattern of Mendelian. You know, Gregor Mendel and Watson and Crick are the two gods of genetics, one in different centuries. Okay, Gregor Mendel still determines the conceptual basis of everything we talked about, and of course Watson and Crick brought it down to the DNA level, which is totally in sync with Mendel's theories as well. And by the way, there was a woman that is not given very much credit to, and she did the groundwork for Watson and Crick, but she died before she could get the Nobel Prize, and her name was Rosalind Franklin, and that's why they named my former medical school after her. So remember, we talked about fragile X syndrome, in which you have triplet repeats. Well, that's not a genetic disorder it follows the classical Mendelian inheritance patterns. Or do you remember when they do forensic pathology and they talk about DNA? Well, they're dealing with really mitochondrial DNA or maternal DNA. So there is a disease of the eyes called Leber optic neuropathy. Okay, and it's a problem where you see degeneration of the ganglion cells in the retina, and this disease is ultimately determined by the mitochondria from the mother's side. Isn't that weird? There may be more diseases like that, but that's the classical one. I apologize if I don't know of any more. There's also the concept of genomic imprinting. So if you have a disease in which there is inactivation of the maternal or paternal allele, that would look like it contradicts Mendel's laws as well, because in Mendel's law, diseases or absence of diseases or autosomal this, dominant, recessive, they follow the fact that there has to be allelic formations. Well, if one side is inactivated, it's not going to follow the Mendelian laws. And finally, we mentioned before, we'll say it again, this is the easy one, is the concept of mosaicism. So we talk about genetic diseases. You all assumed that every cell in the person's body is going to have those carried on mutations. Well, some of them don't. And in many of the cases that are genetic diseases, it's only the gametes that might have the mutations. The somatic cells don't. So those are four examples. Keep them in mind. And I think we're down to our last couple of concepts. This one probably doesn't have to be stressed, but why would you use DNA probes? Well, one is to predict birth defects, or number two, to study tumor cells, not just to classify them, but now more and more to determine what type of therapy would be necessary. Also to classify tumors, because you know if one tumor is this, it's much worse or better, has to be treated different than another one. Even identification of pathogens. Sometimes you can't identify what microbe is present unless you look into that blood and get very specifically the DNA pattern, or whether there's donor compatibility is much better than the old way we did it for typing people for transplant. Paternity testing, and of course, the part of pathology that I hate the most is forensic pathology. For those of you out there who think that forensic pathology is a big part of pathology, or it's the same as pathology, because you've been watching too much damn television, let me tell you, it's a minuscule part of pathology, and I'm prejudiced against it. And finally, when we go to a pathology lab, we look at slides, and those slides are stained with hematoxylin and eosin, nuclear blue, cytoplasm. And on the basis of how those cells are arranged, gone, proliferated, disrupted, we make our diagnosis, and that's still the way it's done in the world. When we need to classify those cells more than just pink and black, and we have to know whether there's a presence of a certain antigen or protein or not, we do immunohistochemistry. We stain the antigens. But guess what? Those antigens, those proteins, are ultimately determined by genes, aren't they? So now, when the presence of gene arrays, we put tumor tissue or normal tissues inside of an analyzer, which we have at Jim's lab, and it can spit out thousands and thousands of genes, maybe of which only a few hundred are clinically important. We have now gone from the tissue to the individual proteins or antigens within that tissue, to the genes that give rise to those proteins. And that's the direction we're going into. And this is why, at the beginning, like we said, no matter when you graduate from medical school, it's not going to be very long before you feel like you're a total idiot in genetics. Okay, we're done. And we've taken a couple minutes of extra time. You know it's time for the music. I know Dr. Kamat is here, and I know he's having fun, and I know he's answered a lot of your questions, and I'm sorry I don't have a totally multitasking mind. Otherwise, I could type answers and talk at the same time, but I'm not that smart. So let's go down to my inspirational song at the end. Oh, somebody, by the way, somebody just asked, so is molecular path the future? The answer is absolutely yes. If you were to take the branch of pathology right now that has the greatest future, you know, things like dermatology and hematology, they're dying down a little bit. But molecular pathology, boom, it's the future. You know, I wish I could live my life again so I could get into it more. We're going to close you off with Bryan Adams singing Everything I Do. See you in 46 hours, folks.
Such a soul.
make sure that your recording is taken after you close your webinar. You then stop the recording. It's like you started the recording before the webinar. You stopped it. Rock on, you buzzards.